Every person in this room has the perfect motive.
Stand back!
For murder.
What do you mean?
Murder.
But only one of these suspects is the murderer. In the movie that makes a scene of the crime. Clue. It's not just a game.
Hey, everybody, welcome to What the Flick, Bibbs, Alonzo. So Bibbs broke the internet this week.
Sorry,
I don't know if you were paying attention. He was having a discussion with John Rocha about whether or not Clue, the 1985 comedy mystery based on the Parker Brothers board game, deserved to be called a classic. Mm-hmm. Rocha said no, you said yes, and you said RT if you think Clue is a classic. And as we speak, that tweet is up to about 20,000 retweets.
Give or take, yeah, it's kind of insane. I chose that hill to die on, and I guess it was the right hill. And John Rocha is a very, very, very esteemed critic. I love John Rocha. He hosts the Cinephiles. It's a great podcast. And he just likes Clue less than I do. He still likes Clue. Mm-hmm. I think everyone likes Clue.
Sure.
The issue for me is, what is the divide between everyone likes it and everyone has consistently liked it, not ironically, but because of its quality for 30 years?
Well,
what is the line between, well, okay, not initially, but yeah. over time, it has built more and more, sure, of a fan base. And after 30 years, and that's based again on people genuinely liking the movie, it's right, not like the Apple where they like it ironically.
Yeah.
How can we not call that a classic? And that's kind of my take on it.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think you've raised an interesting can of worms here, because there used to be, I think, and we've seen this obviously in literature and music and a lot of other disciplines, where for years there was a canon. A canon was sort of based on like academia or a certain handful of old white guys who decided that Hemingway is great and Zora Neale Hurston, who's that? Mm-hmm. And so yeah. I think now with movies we're dealing with the same thing, where for years there was this sort of established notion of like, Charlie Chaplin, yes, and Harold Lloyd, I mean, it
well,
all kind
safety
of,
last at least.
Sure, I know, but you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, there's a division of like, this is a classic and this is not, and then over the years we've seen that fall apart, and I think that you could say that started at least with the French New Wave guys. Before they were filmmakers, they were writing for for Cahiers du Cinéma, and they were defending films like Gun Crazy or certain Alfred Hitchcock films, like, mm-hmm, movies that were kind of dismissed as genre films in the US, that they were actually taking them seriously. When Godard made Breathless and he dedicated it to Monogram Pictures, yeah, that was a sort of low budget outfit that nobody took seriously here, but their brand of like super low budget gangster movies and stuff said something to them. And then now we have the internet, and now the internet is, everybody's a film critic and everybody's got their own decision about what rates as a classic or not.
Well, and everyone does, and there is a certain amount of subjectivity to all of this. We like to think, certainly more and so in the past, that film critics have this sort of rarefied distinction of having seen more movies than anybody else and being a bit more aware of the history and the context and the artistic significance of various films, and having a very distinctive and a very important voice in declaring what is a classic. And I love that the Cahiers du Cinéma, who have now this vaunted reputation, and did then as well,
sure,
for being rather hoity-toity, they did take a stand and say retroactively, we can say that these films have meant so much to us over time and had so much of an influence, and that we recognize artistic qualities that maybe we missed, that they have aged well, mm-hmm, that as opposed to contemporary films, which may have been quote unquote better, but no longer apply as well in various contexts. One of the things that has come up a lot in the Clue conversation is the film Murder by Death, the Neil Simon film,
okay,
which is very similar to Clue in a lot of respects. It's another broad caricatures brought into an old dark house. Someone's gonna get murdered. It's a lot of wacky, wacky humor. But Murder by Death is very distinctly of its time,
yeah,
in terms of its references. It's referencing characters and genres.
It's specifically parodying certain detective characters.
Yeah, yeah, and as those characters have fallen out of favor, the movie's ability to connect with new audiences has fallen. There's a saying my wife says when we're talking about writing, which is character types are funny, stereotypes are not. Mm. Or at the very least, they're only fleetingly funny.
True.
So a character type, like you find in Clue, these are not necessarily specific references to characters that we've seen before. They are individuals who have certain patterns of behavior that drive their actions, and so however they would react in a certain situation becomes funny.
Sure.
if you're just sort of mocking Charlie Chan or Sam Spade, it becomes, well, if you don't know those characters, what good is it?
Right, it's sort of like when you watch, there are like those old Warner Brothers cartoons are still great and funny, but the specific ones where like Bugs Bunny goes to the Hollywood Bowl, and it's like, if you don't know who Eddie Cantor is, like you, the joke is lost on you.
Yeah,
you know?
You get it's a joke and you might chuckle, but you have no idea what's actually happening.
So, yeah. I mean, Clue, I have an interesting back and forth of that movie. I am old enough, I was in college when it came out.
Sure.
So like I was already, and you know, sort of an adult.
And I was a kid.
And I was a fan of it at the time. Like I liked the movie a lot. And but my thing about Clue is that I think that I love what it wants to be. I love the idea of adapting a board game to a movie. I love a screwball comedy murder mystery. Like that's all stuff that I'm into.
Yeah.
I love that cast. Mm-hmm. So I think there are certain times where, and I think this applies to superhero movies if you're a fan, or you know, science fiction if you're a fan. If there are certain movies that I think certain viewers will go into, and they project the movie they want to see on the screen,
yeah.
And then the other movie is sort of doing whatever, and occasionally they'll line up. And when they line up, it's, you know, it's magical. And then even when they don't, you can almost sort of slide it over into the movie you want it to be. So like I think Clue has flaws. I think there are jokes that don't land. I think there are individual performances that aren't.
I think the first act takes a little while to get cooking.
Yeah,
I think that's fair.
You know, yeah. There are gags that are sort of like not great, and they get repeated. You know, like the whole the dog poop thing is sort of tiresome. But generally, I'm a fan of the film. I like the film, and for a long time, I felt like I was the only one who liked the film. And then now, there's this whole generation of people who saw it on HBO when they were nine. Mm-hmm. And Adam Vary has a great oral history of Clue on BuzzFeed, which if you've never read it, I highly recommend it. But like Michael McKean says that one of his theories about why it played so well with little kids watching it was the idea that It's a PG movie. There's nothing in it they can't see, but it's about like blackmail and sex and murder and like all these sort of adult topics.
It's naughty.
It's naughty, but in this like, you know, knockabout farce way that kids can watch.
Well, there's two topics I think you brought up there, and I think are important to talk about. One is in terms of, you know, it's the movie you want to see and the movie it actually is. Clue literally was four different movies. There were four different versions of Clue. When Clue came out, it was shipped very cleverly. It's a neat gimmick with different endings. So depending on what theater you went to, a different person ended up being the murderer.
Right. I saw two of the three endings in theaters.
Ooh, which two did you see?
I saw.
Spoiler alert.
I saw the one where everybody did it except for Mr. Green, and the one where Miss Scarlet does it. I didn't see the Peacock one until the video came out.
I think the version of the film that practically everybody who is retweeting my tweet is defending is the one with every ending together.
Right.
Which was the home video release.
I mean, almost immediately, like I booked Clue, you know, the year after it came out when I was in college at our on-campus theater, and even then they were shipping out prints that had all three endings.
Yeah.
I think because that was part of why this movie tanked, was because people didn't want to see it more than once. They didn't want to accidentally see the wrong ending, so they just didn't see any of them. Critics didn't cotton to the idea of it.
And frankly, the way that the movie ends in the home video version is actually kind of perfect, because it ends with revealing one person as the killer, and then the movie goes, but that's one way it could have ended. Yeah. Here's another way it could have ended. And you see that ending, and then you see the real way, which is the most absurd, you know, conclusion they could possibly have concocted.
And only one of those endings has arguably the movie's funniest line, which is Madeline Kahn's improv as Mrs. White, which is apparently the one thing in the movie that departs from the script.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Because it was so regimented as far as like, you know, the murder mystery itself was such a like Rube Goldberg device.
Tightly constructed.
They couldn't mess with it at all. But the flames on the side of my face is the one thing they got made up. And again, I'm not anti-improv. I just hate these movies now where everything is improv and there's no structure at all.
You should pick and choose. But the home video version, that sort of mad breathlessness contributes, and it builds.
Yeah.
So you see just one person did it, and then this ridiculous ending. And by the end of that movie, everyone's like barreling down hallways, running. Just the movie has built up so much momentum, they can't help but run. And it only contributes to that. But I was too young to see this, I think, in theaters. I don't think I saw this one in theaters. And I totally sympathize with critics at the time who may have only seen one ending, that maybe they saw the Miss Scarlet ending, and it's just like, well, it's kind of a downer ending. I don't know, it doesn't really build to much. So I think the version that we have now is the classic. Maybe the theatrical release is not so much, but this is the version we have now.
Sure.
And I think it's fascinating.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we talk about movies that change over time, and you know, like Ebert would always talk about how he would watch 8 and a half every 10 years and it was different because he was different.
Sure.
You know, Clue, you're right, it is literally a different thing that we're seeing now than people saw in its original release in terms of getting all those endings in there.
Yeah. So, and but the other thing I've noticed is that there are different interpretations of classics, not in terms of, there's all-time classics. I think we can all agree that like Casablanca is a classic, or Citizen Kane is a classic. But then people say, what about cult classics?
Right.
Cult classics are typically considered to be films with a smaller audience.
Yes.
That is incredibly passionate.
Yes.
And The Clue was considered a cult classic for many, many years. But what I just wanted to, I thought maybe a couple hundred people would retweet me on that. But like, I didn't realize it was going to go that far and wide. But apparently, like a lot of people just, I don't think it's a cult anymore. I think it's more of an institution. But the other thing that exists, and I think it's also kind of relates to Clue because a lot of people grew up with it, is the idea of a childhood classic.
Right.
Which is a movie you like as a kid, but doesn't necessarily age well. Many of them do, but they don't necessarily. Many of the films that I saw as a kid and enjoyed are crap now. Like, they're just bad movies.
Yeah, I was just at the New Beverly to see the kiddie matinee of the 1980 Flash Gordon, which I think falls in that category for a lot of people. But they had, the trailers were for Inner Space and Space Camp. And I was like, those are probably movies that if you really liked when you were 8 or 9, you know, that you're still gonna hang on to, but maybe not so much anybody else.
I'll defend Inner Space's weirdness. Yeah. I think there's no other movie quite like Inner Space. It's kind of a miracle that Inner Space ever got made. Yeah. But yeah, it's an odd film. It's the wacky
Fantastic Voyage.
But because we grew up with them, we consider them quite sacred.
Sure, no. I remember I had never seen Midnight Madness, and they screened it in LA, and I went with a bunch of people who grew up on that movie and loved it, and I saw for the first time in my 30s, I was like, what, you know? But hey, there is something about that early imprinting that makes all the difference. And we just saw that again in the last couple of weeks with the Jumanji trailer that dropped. Yeah. Who knew Jumanji was an unassailable classic? But apparently the kids are like freaking out.
I would make the distinction that at least for now, I think it needs, I think in order to be called a classic, I think you need at least like 25 years of distance.
Sure.
You need to really be able to linger over time. But I think at the moment, at the very least for an entire generation, it is a childhood classic. It's a movie they saw over and over and over again. And Jumanji is fine.
Sure, no, it's, I got harmless, nothing against it.
The ending kind of doesn't work for me because it's all weird. It's got that Back to the Future time travel thing. Right. Where it's like sort of, why didn't you warn anybody about all those like horrible disasters, but whatever. Everyone's got one. But I think sometimes maybe we go a little too nuts with our defense of childhood classics, and I think we need to sort of pick our battles.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna die for Space Jam.
I think people, thank you. I was gonna bring up Space Jam.
I'm not gonna die in the Space Jam.
I think that people need to sort of acknowledge the difference between a movie that maybe was, and often with cult classics, part of their cult classicdom is that they weren't hits originally, that audiences didn't get them. You know,
if they were hits and they just kept their audiences, that's not a cult classic. That's just popular.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, a cult classic has a smaller.
Yeah, part of the Clue cult is that it was a dud on its original release.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that people need to be more cognizant of like, okay, I loved this when I was 7, and when I watch it again, I am put back into being 7, but that's not the same as a movie that was good when I was 7 and a movie that was good when I was 25.
Absolutely, and honestly, it's a lot of it is pretty subjective, and some people watch a movie from when they were a kid.
All of this is subjective.
Of course it is, but what I think what we talk about is when we say what is a classic and what is not, where does that line come? I think critics have an element of that because they watch more movies than the typical moviegoer.
Sure.
And they make sure they're consistently well-educated. New generations of critics are well-educated in the entire history of the medium, whereas casual fans can pick and choose and don't have to worry about that necessarily. But I do believe that fans, you know, not audiences as they say, because critics are audiences, and indeed critics are fans too, but just casual audiences do have a vote in what's considered a classic. And if a movie is universally or all but universally liked, loved, hopefully, again, for its merits, not ironically.
Right.
And if it lingers and if it penetrates the culture and people can quote it or people acknowledge that it has an influence on them or their lives or other art that they like, how could it not be a classic, basically? Yeah. And a lot of films sort of sneak up on you like that. Like, who would have thought when A Christmas Story came out that it would now be considered a classic?
Right.
And it's because it aired on TV so damn much, everyone saw it and everyone was like, oh, actually, that's a pretty good movie.
Sure. Well, and that's following in the footsteps of It's a Wonderful Life, which was a super bomb in theaters. Like, yeah. it destroyed Frank Capra's, you know, nascent Liberty Films production company.
Yeah.
But again, it went to the public domain. It was on TV, wallpapered throughout the Christmas season, and audiences grew to love it.
I think a lot of people get sort of like, when they look back on It's a Wonderful Life, it's actually hard to believe that if you weren't there for that time when no one was talking about it. Because it did get some Oscar nominations and stuff.
It did.
On the books. But it got Oscar nominations kind of the way like The Godfather Part 3 got Oscar nominations. It's Capra.
Well, unfortunately, and it lost almost everything it was up for to The Best Years of Our Lives.
Which is great.
Which is great, and also gives you an idea of what audiences did want to see immediately after World War II. You know?
Yeah.
So, I think what I find fascinating about this whole phenomenon about your tweet and it going viral is the notion of what's a classic and says who, you know?
Yeah.
And so I would argue that if enough people say that, two shot.
What the fuck?
If enough people say that Clue is a classic, then that makes it a classic whether you like it or not.
I agree. But you know what? Respectable minds can differ. I know a lot of people who have indeed responded by just saying, I just think it's okay. Some people just don't even like it, and that's fine too.
Yeah, I don't love the Shawshank Redemption, but I mean, like, IMDb numbers don't lie, you know.
Yeah, there you go.
Unless you're a bunch of, like, you know, sensitive boys giving a one to Ghostbusters without seeing it, but that's another story.
That is another story. And that's another one I think will be sort of reappreciated over
totally.
Time. But, I think it's a conversation we need to have. I'm glad I got to have it. I feel kind of bad for breaking the internet. It feels kind of weird. Like, I was just sort of like,
enjoy
I'm sorry
it.
I bothered you with my retweet. And I'm actually kind of sorry. I feel like maybe that retweet is maybe steamrolled a more in-depth conversation we can have just about Clue's qualities and failings. And so, again, if you don't like the film, or if you have a decent reason why you don't like the film, or even if you just think it's have that conversation too, and don't let anyone shut you down. I see a lot of people just like, well, you know, anyone doesn't like Clue is no friend of mine. Calm down.
Yeah, everybody relax.
Calm down. It's nice to be able to all join hands on Twitter and talk about something we all like for a change, but don't let that turn sour.
Sure. And if you are a fan of Clue, you might check out the new comic book version from IDW. No, I'm not going to plug.
You did a commentary track for your podcast.
Okay, fine. Yes.
Plug it. Go to
linoleum-knife.com. Dave and I did an entire commentary track about Clue. But also, IDW just put out a Clue comic book that is very tongue-in-cheek and very, like, fourth wall breaking. And if you're a fan of this stuff, you will probably like it too.
I'll have to check that out.
Yeah. All right. So, all right. You know, you'll tell us in the comments your thoughts about Clue and classics and everything else, I'm sure. But thanks for watching.
One plus two.
Plus two.
One.
Plus two.